In this question, we'll be looking at the preparation of the statement of cash flows for this Palmer Limited. We're given the statement of P&L for the year. Then you're given the statement of financial position. You can see that. And then you have additional information. And we are required to prepare the group statement of cash flows for the year ended 31st December 2009. In conformity with IS7 statement of cash flows. So, as always, we always start by drawing an outline of the answer. We now put the various headings. We always start with cash flows from operations. Or from operating activities. And our first item is profit before tax, PBT. After which we have our non-cash adjustments, where we leave five or so line items. Then we have working capital changes. We leave around four items, four lines. And then we say less actual taxes paid, less actual finance costs paid, and this should give us net cash flows from operations. Our next subheading is cash flows from investing activities. And we leave five or so line items. Then we have cash flows from financing activities. Again, we leave five or so line items. Then we get net cash flows for the year. Then we have cash and cash equivalents at start of the year, and cash and cash equivalents at end of the year. So having done that, we start with the easiest marks. Now the easiest marks has to start by being the PBT. So just come and take the PBT, profit before tax, and see it here, 178. Come and post it, PBT, 178. After that, we look at the cash and cash equivalents at the start and as at the end. So we look under current assets and current liabilities. So what do we see? We have fair value through P&L investments. These are cash equivalents. Cash and bank balance is also cash equivalent. So those are balances we have to take. Are there any overdrafts? Let's see. There's an overdraft there. So it means that at any point, we're going to have a netting off. So let me have this as my working one. which is cash and cash equivalents. So I'm just going to 2.9 and 2.8. So we have cash and bank. I've seen fair value through P&L investments. And then there is overdraft. Those are the first things that I saw. Let me just quickly look at them again. So what do we have in 09? We have 15 and 14. 15 is the fair value. Through P&L, cash and bank is 14. What about at the start? There's 20 fair value, 0 cash and bank. So cash and bank was 0, but fair value through P&L we have 20. Then we go to liabilities. What did we notice? We notice that there is this overdraft of nil and an overdraft of 23. It's going to appear as a negative. And I can also see that there was a bank loan, a portion that had been reclassified, must be part of this overall bank loan. But I can see there is an overall bank loan there of 30. So this 30 must be part of this 22 and 30 that was above there, but there was a reclassification or something like that. But since it's current, let's just put it here. So this gives me negative 1. This gives me negative 33. So these are the figures that I come and post. So at the end of the year, which is 09, I have negative 1. At the start of the year, I have negative 33, which means that my net cash flows for the year must be 32. So I'm trying to ensure that the sum of all my three headings will give me 32. Okay? So let's now go through the other entries. So what I do is I read through the notes and identify if there are any free marks that are there available for the taking. So what do we see? Note number one, we acquired some equipment for 50 million. So that's already a free mark. This one goes to investing activities. So let me just post it. And investing activities. Purchase of equipment. 50. We are told that they also revalued their land upwards by 40 million. In addition, items of plant were sold at a loss of 10 million. So this 10 million will go to the non-cash adjustments. It's going to be added back because it is an expense. Okay. Now, I know very well that I have to work out the disposal proceeds, but I'll leave that till later. Okay. I'm just looking for free marks. Note number two, we are told that cost of sales includes depreciation of 64 million. So 64 million will appear as a non-cash adjustment. 64, again, it's going to be positive. You are adding back the expenses. Note number three, there was no gain or loss on the fair value through P&L investments. So nothing to adjust there. When we'll be looking at the movement in the P&L investments, we'll determine whether there's any acquisition that happened. Then number four, we're told that intangible assets comprised of the following. And you can see them, goodwill, patents, licenses, they have moved from the initial position to this position. Trade licenses for the group companies were renewed for 100 million. So that is a investment. So this goes to investing activities. Remember, we're just looking at the easy parts. Okay, so the other computations we leave till later. So for example, we know that there has some impairment losses that we have to compute later. Okay, let's go on. We're told that the company made a bonus issue of 1 for every 10 shares held. The bonus issue was financed from a revaluation reserve. The company also made a transfer, blah, blah. So this tells me that probably there must be some working for the shares that were issued for cash. We'll work that out later. Okay, so we're just going through and identifying the easy marks. Having done that, we come back here and look for anything above this line that is non-cash in nature. And automatically, I always put my finance costs there. So under working capital changes, I come here, finance costs, and the amount of the finance costs is 6. So we add it back because it is an expense, okay? And then we look through the liabilities and determine whether there is any accrued finance cost. And there is. Can you see these? Accrued interest of 3 and 1. This tells me that the amount of the finance cost that was actually paid must have been different. So I'm just going to have my working 2 as being finance costs paid. So you can see that at the start of the year, the accrual was 1, at the end it was 3. So the start was 1, at the end it was 3. And then from the P&L, we have charged 6. So the question is, what was the amount that we paid? What is that X? So just say 1 plus 6 minus X equals to 3. And then we solve for that X. And we get that X can only be equals to 4. So that's what we post here under less actual finance cost paid. Working 2, the answer is 4. Okay, very well. Still on the P&L, what other item we have that is non-cash in nature? It is this share of profit after tax of associate, which is 4. So this one will be again non-cash adjustments. Share of associates, PAT, 4. And since it was an income, we deduct it. Instead, we should determine what was the amount of the dividend that we received from the associate. So, let me work out, working number 3. What was the dividend from associate? So, again, I use my timeline approach. I look for the valuation of my associate in the SFP. And what do I tell? The associate was at 16 at the start and 19 at the end. And during the year, from the P&L, the associate has gone up by how much? It has gone up by 4. We can tell that from the P&L. Isn't it? Remember, the equity method says that you need to increase the cost of your associate by your post-acquisition profits. So the question then becomes, what was the dividend that must have been paid? So it's just be 16, not paid, but actually received, because this is an income. Yeah, we are receiving the dividend from the associate. So 16 plus 4 minus X equals to 19. So we get that X equals to 1. So we put that under investing activities, dividend from associate. positive cash flow? One, we go back to our P&L. Any other thing that stands out? There is none. We always assume that all these other items are cash in nature unless told otherwise. So we can now look at the statement of financial position, and the concept is we go through the various items on a line by line basis. Okay? And as is my way of operating, I always leave my PPE for last because it usually has a lot of complications. So let's look at the other, what I would call easier aspects. So I look at my intangible assets first. What do I have under intangible assets? They were mentioned in the notes. You can see it was 60 and then became 130. But let's see the note in greater detail. What we have here, we can see the 60 and the 130 here, isn't it? So the question is, what was the impairment of these intangible assets? Considering that we have already factored in the renewal at 100 million, that we had already recognized it. So what I'll do is I'll just have a working there, working 4, which is on impairment loss of the intangible assets. So let me just look at each of them in turn. So goodwill, it was 40, then became 36. So it means that the drop was 4. That was the impairment loss. What about for the next one, which was patents? They were 15 and then they became 12. That's a drop of 3. What about licenses? They were 5 and then they became 82. Remember though that we acquired additional ones at 100. So what was the drop? So it's just a matter of saying 5 plus 100 minus x equals to 82. So 105 minus 82 we get is 23. So it means that our total impairment will be given by 4 plus 3 plus 23, which when I add gives me 30. So that's what I recognize under non-cash adjustments, impairment losses, 30. They are losses, so the expenses, so we add them up. Yeah, the reference is working number what? Working 4. It's always good to reference your workings. So with that, we are done. So intangible assets, we are done with that. We go to the next one, which is on the available for sale financial assets. We're told at the start they were 30, and as at the end, they were 40. Has there been any other change in the available for sale financial assets? So let's just look through the notes and see what we have. What we have available for sale financial assets. I'd seen that somewhere. Deposition. There was no gain in there. Huh? Available for sale financial assets. No. Valuation reserve. So no mention anywhere in the notes. However, let's just quickly look at the equity and see whether there was anything. And I can see here, available for sale reserve. Uh-huh. So at the start of the year, the reserve was 0. At the end, the reserve was 5, meaning that the reserve has gone up, meaning that we must have revalued our available for sale assets upwards by 5, isn't it? So, let's see. Working 5, available for sale assets. So we have the opening balances at the start and as at the end of the year. So 30 and 40. And we have the revaluation gains, which we've just seen from equity, which is 5. So the question becomes, what else has transpired? And 30 plus 5 gives you 35. So the only thing that can have happened is a purchase for a certain value x, isn't it? So it's just a matter of saying 30 plus 5 plus x gives you 40. And find that x is 5. So we must have acquired new financial assets at a cost of 5. Since it was an acquisition, we are going to have it in brackets. Okay, so we are done with that. Investment in associate, we are already done with that. We looked at the dividend from associate, so there's nothing more to do there. Let's now look at the current assets. So we have the movements in inventory. You can tell inventory at the start was 188, it is now 284. So that's an increase. We're going to have that in working capital changes. Increase in inventory, 284 minus 188 gives you 96. And since it's an increase in an asset, you're going to have it as a negative. While we are at that, can we look at the others? So inventory, we are done. So accounts receivable. It was initially that 136, it is now 198, so that's an increase in receivables. Gives you 62, so again, negative. While we are there, can we just as well just look at the liabilities and look at the payables? So the payables, we are told, was 186, is now 231. So again, that's an increase. -186, which gives you 45. Great. Let's go back. So what else don't we have? We had already looked at fair value through P&L investments and cash bank balances. These were part of cash and cash equivalents. So we are done with that. We now go to the equity and we start by looking at share capital and share premium. So there must have been some shares that were issued for cash because you can see an increase in the share capital and the share premium, isn't it? However, I remember seeing a note here talking about a bonus issue. Let's look at number 5. It says that on 1st January 09, the holding company made a bonus issue. Remember, a bonus issue is made for free. One for every 10 shares. The bonus issue was financed from the revaluation reserve, and the company also made a transfer from revaluation reserve to retained earnings. So I'm interested in the first part. Yeah, the bonus issue. So let's work out working number 6. Shares issued for cash. So the first step I have to do is determine the bonus issues. And you're told it was one for every 10, isn't it? One share for every 10 held as at 08. Now the question is, as at 08, how many shares do we have? This was the valuation of the shares, each valued at 10 each. So, one new share for every 10 shares held. And we are saying that the shares held have a cumulative value of 100 million. You can just use values directly, and then instead of using the number of shares and then multiply by 10 again. So it means that the new shares that were issued have a valuation of 10 million. So when I want to know the issues for cash, all I have to do is draw a timeline, then have my share capital, share premium at the start, share capital, share premium at the start. So what do we have as share capital and share premium? Let's just check. So at the start, we have 100 and a premium of 20. At the end, we have 150 and a premium of 70. Let's add them up. Now, we know that there was a bonus issue that increased our valuation by 10. So the balance must have been the cash issue, X. So 120 plus 10 plus X equals to 220. So X can only be how much? 90. So 90 must be the cash that we raised, isn't it? So cash flows from financing activities . It's a positive cash flow, have it as 90. We move on. So we are done with share capital, we are done with share premium. Let's now look at retained profits here. The retained profits will help us in determining the dividends. So what are we told about the retained profits? At the start was 326, at the end was 364. And we know that we have had a profit attributable to the parent of 116. So we'll just draw a timeline to illustrate that. So I'll look at retained earnings. So at the start, at the end, and we've just seen that from P&L, what the parent got was how much? Was 116. So it increases. What other transaction has occurred? There was a mention in the notes affecting retained earnings. The last note there. We are told that the company also made a transfer of 2 million from the revaluation reserve to retained earnings, meaning that it went up. So the question is, what was the dividend that was paid so that it can reduce our retained earnings? So we just say 326 plus 116 plus 2 minus x is 364. Then we get that x can only be how much? Can only be 80. That becomes the dividend paid by the group. And we put it under financing activities. Cash outflow. The next item, we are already done with the available for sale reserve. So revaluation of the property will be left for last because we'll be looking at it when we look at PPE. So let's now look at our NCI. Our NCI will give us the dividend that we've paid to NCI. So we can tell that the NCI was 20 at the start, then became 27. And of course, there must have been some increase to the NCI. You can see it here, an increase of 8. So dividend paid to the NCI, just by looking at the NCI movement. So P&L, NCI have gotten 8. So what is the dividend? 20 plus 8 minus x equals to 27. So x is 1. So again, it appears under financing activities. Okay. So we're done with the entire note, I believe. The next working that we have has to do with our debentures. We can see that our debentures at the start were 20 and as at the end they are now 60. So we must have acquired additional monies so that our liabilities can go up. So we take that directly to financing activities, issue of debentures, which must be the difference between 60 and 20, which gives you 40. It's a cash inflow, so have it as a positive. Bank loan, we've already factored that in. Deferred tax, we are yet to factor in deferred tax. So deferred tax and current tax, where is that? This deferred tax and this current tax will help us in determining the actual taxes to be paid, the number that we come and put here, isn't it? So let's have that as our working nine. Actual taxes paid. So current tax, deferred tax. Current tax, deferred tax. What do we have at the start of the year? At the start of the year, deferred tax is 28. Current tax is 32. At the end of the year, deferred tax is 62. At the end of the year, current tax is 26. So let's put those numbers. Add them up. Then we ask ourselves, from P&L, what is the income tax expense? So we go to the P&L. Look for the income tax expense, here it is, and the amount is 54. So 54 goes to increase our liability, so we have it as a plus. Then we ask ourselves, what was the amount that we had paid? X. So we just say 60 plus 54 minus X equals to 88. So what is X? X can only be 26. Less actual taxes paid, 26. So we are done with all that. Overdraft we are done, payables we are done, bank loan we are done, accrued interest we are done, current tax we are done. So the only item that is now pending is the item we had delayed, we had left for last, which was our PPE. So let's work out our PPE. And remember, with PPE, what are we trying to find out? Disposal proceeds, isn't it? Because we already have all other numbers. We have depreciation already. And we have the purchase of PPE. So the only thing we don't have is the disposal of PPE. So let's work that out. So we draw our timeline. What was the PPE at the start and as at the end of the year? At the start was 366, at the end was 378. During the year, what changes have happened? We know that there was a purchase of the PPE of 50. It was given to us in the notes, if you recall. We bought it at 50, isn't it? Uh-huh. We also told that there was a revaluation upwards of 40 million. We also know that there is a depreciation that was charged, and the depreciation amount that we had recognized was 64 million. So it's just a matter of determining what was the NBV of the disposal. Remember, this one is giving us the NBV. So 366 plus 50 plus 40 minus 60. So disposal should reduce, yeah? Minus X equals to 378. So we get X equals to 14. However, remember that this X is the NBV of disposal. However, in the statement of cash flows, we look at actual cash flows. So it's a matter of looking through the notes and seeing what was the gain or loss on disposal. So we are told that items of plant were sold at a loss of 10. So if their net book value is, as we have said, 14, and we sold them at a loss of 10, how much money did we sell them for? The answer can only be 4. So it means that the proceeds of the disposal can only be NBV minus the loss. 14 minus the loss of 10, which gives you 4. So this 4 is what we take to investing activities as the disposal proceeds. So that's a cash inflow. So with that, I believe we are done with all of the notes. Is there anything that we have left out? Anything? Yes, there is an item here. How did I miss this? There's a bank loan here, which moved from 30 to 22. Is it there? It is not there. So let's put it. Repayment of loan. That's a cash outflow. Okay. So I believe with that we are now done. I don't think there's any other pending item. Let's add them up and see whether the subtotals for the three subheadings will give us 32. That's our aim. So non-cash adjustments, add them up. I'm getting 106. Working capital changes, I'm getting 113 negative. So when I add them up, I get 171 minus 26 minus that gives me net cash flows from operations is 141 positive. Cash flows from investing, when I add them up, I'm getting negative 150. This is my net cash flow. Investing. Then I add the ones from the financing. They are giving me 41. So now when I add 41 minus 150 and then plus 141, what does it give me? It gives me 32. So it means that my equation is in balance. And that is what was expected of us in this exam question.